In the first segment, we discussed with Dr. Sencer the growth of CDC during the 60s and 70s. But there were some setbacks, too. Some of the programs were transferred out of CDC.
One of the first programs to be transferred out of CDC, this room that we're in now, is a, I guess I'd say, a relic of, because this was a room that was designed in 1954 for the new construction, and by the time it was done, the technology of audiovisual had so changed that we didn't need a three-story building to fly sets in. We've still got a lot of waste space up there. I kept trying to get you to put floors in it and make three floors out of it, but you never seemed to get around to it. But in 1960, when I came down here, the audiovisual program was part of the training branch. And tremendous drive for separateness. They did not want to be identified with the training branch, and finally we agreed to a separation as a separate program within CDC. But the whole emphasis became one of developing audiovisuals for the sake of audiovisual, as though audiovisual were a program itself rather than supporting other programs. And the drive for continued separateness and reporting kept on, and finally in 1966, it was transferred to the Library of Medicine. They thought they were going to get transferred out of CDC and report only to the secretary or something like that, and ended up reporting to the Library of Medicine, which created even probably more problems for the administration of NMAC than they had when they were part of CDC. Lots of stories we could tell about that, of flagpoles being put up.
You're using a pronoun, they. There were some interesting personalities involved in this,
well,
Sencer.
Dr.
Talk about that or pull your punches.
Oh, no, Jim Lieberman was a very ambitious individual. I won't pull any punches. When he came into public health service, Jim was a veterinarian, but Jim Steele, who was the chief of the veterinary program, wouldn't let him be commissioned as a veterinarian because he'd gone to a veterinary school that wasn't accredited at that time. Even though Jim had subsequently gone on, gotten an MPH and so on, he had the public health service as sanitarian rather than as a veterinary officer, and he finally was able to get that change, but he had a lasting enmity for Jim Steele as a result of that, and he never particularly liked me either, I don't think, because I wouldn't let him have everything he wanted, and so as soon as he became separate, he finagled with Phil Lee to get a star, become the first veterinary officer to get a star grade, and they interceded so that Jim Steele got his star at the same time, which would have really crushed Jim if he hadn't. But the first thing that Jim did when he became separate was to order a flagpole to be erected on the building so he could fly his own flag. And this was just happened to be right outside Jim Steele's window. And this was giving our procurement people fits, because not only did he order the flagpole, but he ordered two flagpoles, one for the annex over at Powder Mill Road.
Plaster Bridge Road,
and he ordered flagpoles to put on his car. You know, these little things you put up on the fenders, and nobody ever done anything like that around here. And John Barron just didn't know how to handle that one. But when he got transferred to the Library of Medicine, I saw Marty Cummings, who was the director, and said something about the flagpole, and the hell. And so he wrote Jim a memo saying, take the flagpole down. And Jim says, I can't do it because it will endanger the people who put it up, or the workmen. So then the memo comes back, well, how did you get it up? And this went back two or three times. Finally, the flagpole was taken down. And we'd find signs all around town pointing this direction to NMAC. CDC would put up a sign, Jim would get a bigger sign to put up, and the parking lot. We had all sorts of very childish squabbles over this. And then they were finally organizationally transferred to the Library of Medicine and physically transferred to the Lister Hill Center for Bio medical communications technology or something like that. And I understand that in the Federal Register a few weeks ago, they actually announced that there was no longer a National Center for Medical Audiovisuals. It has deceased, which, you know, to me, that if the program had stayed as a support program to other training activities of the public health service, this is what it was all about, that they wanted to do audiovisual for the sake of audiovisual communication rather than in support of program. About the same time, the pesticide program began wriggling back and forth between CDC and other places. In 1966, 65, I guess, they created an Office of Pesticide in Washington and put non-pesticide people in charge of it. One of the first things that Dr. Prindle did as chief of BDPEC was not only give us a quarantine program, but he gave us the pesticide program with the understanding that we would put some scientific base into it, which we did with Doc Simmons and toxicologists and people who were concerned with the use of pesticides. We had community demonstrations in areas of high pesticide use, low pesticide use, and so on. Then the subsequent reorganization, it was taken away and put in the Food and Drug Administration, and they came down and chopped it up into three pieces and destroyed its
was this
viability.
Before the creation of the EPA?
About the same time as creation of EPA, and the Food and Drug Administration's attitude was, if we hide it well enough, they can't take it from us.
But that didn't work.
That didn't work. They still found it and put it back together. But it really lost its good science base by this sort of a transfer.
It lost a lot of its good people, too.
People just wouldn't go to a basically a regulatory agency, which Food and Drug was. I think this is one of the things that, except for the laboratory licensure program, CDC has resisted being a regulatory agency and has worked by trying to show that facts were sufficient enough to make changes rather than invoking laws and regulations.
And you concur with that? That's
absolutely
been your philosophy.
Sure. Yeah. Particularly, you know, in my present position, where we've got all sorts of codes and laws and so on, that doesn't do anything to protect the public health good. It's still basic epidemiology and disease investigation that ends up protecting the public.
We've talked a lot about many of the programs in CDC, but we haven't talked about some. There were two that were operationally overseas, the malaria program and the smallpox program. And would you like to...
Yeah, there are two very different programs. One was an entrenched program that had been developed initially by AID, one of their big health programs overseas. In 1966, everything seems to happen in 1966, an agreement was signed between the Secretary and the Secretary of State to transfer the health aspects of AID to the Public Health Service, and the first thing to be transferred was the malaria program, and it was transferred operationally to CDC. Prior to that, AID had two people in their Washington office running the malaria program. Transferred it to CDC, they increased it to about 16 people because they didn't like the idea of giving it up to somebody else and they wanted more oversight. And we suddenly were faced with running the largest payroll in Haiti. The malaria program in Haiti was a direct U.S. Embassy operation and was payrolled out of CDC. We were buying tons and tons of DDT. We had people in Nepal and in Thailand, Vietnam, all scattered all over the world, Ethiopia. It's created some interesting complications. Many of these people who were overseas had their entire salary deducted and deposited in various ways in the United States, so they weren't issued a check overseas. Well, when this was transferred to our central computer, central payroll, in Washington, it couldn't figure out the fact that somebody would get a zero check, so it began printing out a bunch of 1 cent checks, and we rescued those in New Orleans. For some reason or other, they all got shipped to New Orleans because we could just see that the first time that we ran the payroll, people got paid a penny. That would look good, but we never really able to get a hold of the malaria program because it was so ingrained in the AID bureaucracy. Whereas the smallpox program was something that was started de novo, really out of the ideas of people at CDC and WHO. It did not have an existing superstructure overseas. It was something that we were able to develop. D.A. Henderson was the driving force here at CDC. Jim Watt was sort of the intermediary.
Who is Jim Watt?
Jim Watt was the director of the Office of International Health.
In the Public Health Service.
In the Public Health Service. He was a good friend of the Surgeon General's. They worked together at the Heart Institute, and so he sort of tried to keep Surgeon General out of trouble and meddled in a lot of things. This is nothing that I wouldn't tell Jim Watt, that he meddled in too many things. And he would tend to agree, but he liked to meddle. And then there's Carol Roschke, who really is the unsung hero of the smallpox program, as far as I'm concerned. Carol was a Czechoslovak epidemiologist at WHO, who was the one voice at WHO who kept yelling that we ought to be eradicating smallpox, that it's feasible to do, and he was really the driving force that got it through WHO, hired DA to Henderson, who had been Alex's right-hand bower here for many years, to go to Geneva and run the program. About that time, CDC was given sort of an unwritten agreement that we would handle the West African part of the smallpox program.
That was the United States commitment.
And the United States made a commitment, yeah. Money and personnel-wise. I said personnel-wise, one of these Washington things that I keep trying to get away from, prioritize and personnel-wise. The beginning of this, I remember an old Arkansas doctor by the name of Dr. A.C. Curtis called one day and said, how would you...
He was with AID.
He was with AID, yeah. And he said, how would you like to eradicate measles in West Africa? And I said, only if we could do it along with smallpox. He said, well, we're not interested in smallpox. We want to do something about measles. Well, this was down at his level in Africa, and he didn't know that higher up there was this talk of smallpox eradication. So it became smallpox measles program in West Africa. And this was our first real venture with overseas assignments and working and starting and recruiting and putting people over. And we had our fits and starts and good days and bad days, but they were really exciting days of having 60 people scattered around 19 countries of West Africa. We had people in Timbuktu, and we were involved in all sorts of intrigues, and but we got the job done. And
on what timetable?
About 3 years ahead of time, and at about 40% of the original projected cost. This was interesting because AID would never once talk about the smallpox eradication program in their budget presentations because it was a success. I'm convinced that it made them look bad that it went so well. And your current director of CDC is, to me, the real unsung hero of this whole thing. That he was a medical missionary in Nigeria for the Lutheran Church and had agreed to take on the smallpox eradication effort in eastern Nigeria. Well, he didn't get enough vaccine to vaccinate everybody, so he started it off with the concept of finding cases and vaccinating around them, while the rest of the program in West Africa and the whole world, as a matter of fact, had been built on a concept of mass vaccination, the jet injector gun, and just vaccinate everybody you can see. Well, Bill started it on an epidemiologic basis of surveillance and containment and showed that he could just interrupt the transmission of malaria of smallpox in East Nigeria abruptly, where in other parts of West Africa it was just gradually trailing off. And Don Millar then picked this and instituted in the whole West African program, and West Africa just suddenly took a nosedive, and there was no smallpox transmission. But it was Bill who really was the one that devised the technique and sold it and then implemented it.
Does it not surprise you that despite the fact that smallpox had been around for
generations, that the vaccine had been available for years, that here we were in 1966 really knowing nothing about the epidemiology of this disease?
Oh, I guess I wouldn't say it wouldn't surprise me. We see epidemiology in the sense that it's used at CDC is pretty much a United States commodity. The British tend to be more desk-oriented in their epidemiology and theoretical, whereas Alex Langmuir's hole in the symbolic hole in the shoe of getting out tracking things down was something that really hadn't been done. And this was one of the problems in malaria, that very little was really understood about the malaria epidemiology of how you interrupt transmission. And it wasn't just the not knowing the epidemiology of smallpox. It was the fact that CDC put into the field the whole concept of management of disease control programs using not just physicians but public health advisors and approaching this as a management challenge, not just as a disease challenge, but how do we get the job done? And as Bill well knows, this was the turning point in the whole smallpox program in Africa, in India, which was the biggest reservoir of smallpox in the world. And it was Bill Foege going over there and then yelling for help, and got Bill and Stu Kingman and Tony Scardacci and people of that ilk to come over and organize this on a managerial basis, which really was instituting supervision, I think, into a system that had never been. People in other parts of the world don't think in terms of supervision. It's as we do in this country, of having a boss, a sub-boss, a sub-sub-boss, and really making sure the job got done. And this is what really did smallpox in. It was management rather than just vaccinating.
There are those who charge that you robbed the rest of CDC to accomplish that. How do you plead to that charge?
If that's robbery, I'm proud of it. I think that at the same time that we were robbing other things, there were other things growing at CDC. Carl Tyler's program was growing by leaps and bounds.
Which is what program?
The family planning evaluation program.
How did we get into the family planning?
We got into family planning.
That was a real change, was it not, for CDC?
Well, we got into it because, again, personalities. Alex Langmuir, who was head of the epidemiology program, had a personal interest in the population problems. And we had an EIS officer assigned to Vermont by the name of Nick Wright, and he wasn't working out in Vermont. And after a year, Alex said, can we transfer him back to Georgia and put him in the state health department doing evaluation of family planning? And so we did. And shortly thereafter, we got one of these communications down from on high that went out to all parts of the public health service, finding out what we were doing in family planning. And it turns out that we reported back one person. It turned out that we got our knuckles wrapped on as it went up. Our report went up, the idea of spending communicable disease money on family planning. But when it got to the top and they found out this was the only body in the public health service that could be identified as working full-time on family planning, suddenly we were very popular and we got kudos for doing it. And the next year we included a line in our budget that in general epidemiology that said that while the population problem is not an infectious disease, it has reached epidemic proportions, and the techniques that have been used in epidemiology of other things are applicable to the evaluation of the effectiveness of family planning programs. And that was sort of the legislative base for going ahead and doing something about it. And the next year we had Carl Tyler and Bob Hatcher come into the program, and Bob went off to Columbus, Georgia to learn about a local activity. Carl became the recruitment center and the development center, and I think it's shown over the years that this has been a wonderful intake mechanism for some of the highest caliber people we've had in CDC.
In the 80s, you see many of the results of that program.
We see Carl Tyler now in charge of the epidemiology program, Ward Cates in charge of the venereal disease program. These people are now throughout CDC and throughout the country and a variety of things throughout the world. So, you know, if that be robbery, make the best of it, most of it.
Another program that we got involved in that certainly doesn't fit the classical CDC mold was the kidney donor program. You developed some interest in that and did some very interesting work in that one time.
Well, here again, one day when somebody sent this man to us that said, you know, we've got a big problem up in Virginia right now. This was in one of the 74 when there was the oil embargo and there was a motor vehicle 55 mile an hour speed limit was being enforced and motor vehicle accidents were going down. And this man was the manager for the renal transplant network of Central America, or Central American state, North American, but you know, the Virginia, New Jersey axis. And he said, all of our donors have come from automobile accident fatalities in the past, and we're not getting them anymore because of the speed limit. And we've got people waiting for transplants, and what can we do about that? And this was in the early days of our health education program, so we thought this would be a good health education initiative to encourage people to donate their kidneys. Well, it turned out that it wasn't a health education problem. It was one, again, a management problem of getting people in emergency rooms to remember to ask. And so this was the beginning of, again, starting off as a health education initiative and realizing it's really a management problem and utilizing management techniques to begin to get kidneys donated. From there, you know, the chronic disease program moved into diabetes, and so we've got a fairly sizable and good chronic disease epidemiology around birth defects. And all of these things were growing at the same time the smallpox program was growing. So, I mean, quarantine fed a lot.
Before, I want to double back on the smallpox program. The West Africa campaign was financed out of American foreign aid monies.
Right.
And they, in effect, contracted with CDC to
right.
run that program. After that, there was no foreign aid money.
There was
the
no
program. There was still smallpox in the world after mm-hmm. Africa, West Africa.
Mm-hmm.
So CDC's involvement was very different in West Africa and then subsequently, right?
Yeah, we had to pay our own way. WHO paid some of the travel costs and the operational costs, but we were paying the salaries of the people that we were putting out. And we put out, I don't know how many hundred people over the years, including you and Bill Foege, and, you know, the most of CDC at one point or another had some involvement in the smallpox program, and we kept justifying our expenditures on the basis that it's cheaper to eradicate the disease overseas than to run the quarantine program. Mike Lane and Norm Axnix put together a paper that showed that the first year savings on the smallpox eradication effort was something approaching $1 billion in the United States just from non-vaccinating people, the fact that we did not have to vaccinate people. We saved this much money. This was costs of vaccination, time lost from work, going to the doctor, and so on. So it was a cost-effective program as well as being a humanitarian program.
We continue to reap the benefits of that.
I mean, that's $1 billion each year, and you discount it at 4% or whatever they do, and
well,
you made a whole lot of money.
The last figures I saw was that we return in money that we don't have to spend what the total amount we spend every 3 months.
Yeah. Yeah.
Another special effort that took place while you were director was involved hospital-acquired infections.
Scenic,
right.
Well, the epidemiology program over the years had been doing investigations of hospital-acquired infections, and each year they would come in their program planning session with more money for hospital infections. And we'd keep saying, you know, why? And so one year they came in and said, well, if all the hospitals did this, then we could save 3.6 patient days per admission or something like that. And so I said, all right, that's big money these days. Now, let's do a study that will be scientifically sound enough that we can sell it to the Social Security Administration to make this a condition of payment under Medicare. that if a hospital has a kind of hospital infections control program that will prevent these extra 3 days, then they'll be eligible for Medicare payments. This started small, and with a great deal of resistance, I might add. Some people just didn't like the idea of having to have, you know, a bureaucratic reason for doing something. But as I understand it, has grown considerably, mainly after I left, until it was eating up a fair share of the budget, getting the Scenic project done.
Scenic being what?
An acronym.
An acronym for a survey done of hospital-acquired infections, right?
Well, I can't remember what it stands for, but nosocomial infection survey for the evaluation of nosocomial infection control.
Right.
And this got to be not just a little thing, but a highly statistically oriented, validating survey that...
big and costly.
Big and costly. But I saw Bob Haley yesterday, and I said, when's it going to get into Medicare regulation? He said, we have the exact place for it to go in the new DRG regulations. I'll wait and see.
During your
That's when CDC went through the looking glass.
Yeah. You want to elaborate on that?
Well, each of the training modules that used to train people to work in the program had a quotation from Alice in Wonderland.
During your time as director of CDC, a lot of changes took place in the overall governmental framework that the center operated in. Washington, in the executive branch, the department, the public health service, and on Capitol Hill. Could we talk a bit about that?
When I came to CDC, CDC was a division in a bureau in the public health service, which was an agency. And then we went from a division to bureau to agency status. And with each one of these movements up, we got closer to the throne room, if you will, of the seats of power. And each time we moved up, we had more responsibility in terms of our budgeting and so on. I worked under each of the secretaries of HEW into Mr. Califano's administration, beginning with Ovita Kulp-Hobby. I have two memories of Ovita Kulp-Hobby. I never saw the lady, but I was in Washington at that time, and in Washington they had rules and regulations about when you could turn on the air conditioning in buildings and so on, and you weren't supposed to have windows open. And Ed Blomquist, who was head of the TB program's office, was across the street but facing the secretary's office, and one day he got a letter from the secretary saying, your window is open, please close it. It's not time of the year to have an open window. The other thing I remember about Ovita Kulp-Hobby was that she made the classic statement as we ran out of polio vaccine in 1955, just after it had been licensed, whoever would have anticipated the demand for polio vaccine? Of course, this was the previous year, you know, we'd had thousands and thousands of children becoming ill with polio and so on. And this was her response to that. But it really wasn't until the 70s that we really began having much in the way of direct dealings with the secretary's office, with the abolition of HSMAHA, Health Services and Mental Health Administration. CDC reported directly to the assistant secretary, and that meant we had to go to staff meetings of the secretary, and so we were involved with Elliot Richardson and Casper Weinberger and
there was a transition.
David Matthews.
There was a transition in the Public Health Service from the time when it was run by the Surgeon General to the time when there were Assistant Secretaries of Health who were really in charge.
Yeah, well, this took place, again, 1966 is when that happened. Bill Stewart became Surgeon General, and he and Phil Lee became the Assistant Secretary.
Right.
And they gave away the family jewels. They gave away all of their budget program. They gave away everything. They wanted to run a neat, tight little office, and it ended up, it was neat, tight, and little, the two of them and the two secretaries. And Jim Kelly had stripped them of all of their staff.
Jim Kelly being
the comptroller of the Department of HEW and a very smart, able bureaucrat. But it ended up with Phil Lee and Bill Stewart thinking they were running the public health service, but they weren't. And then over the years, I'll hand it to Charlie Edwards, who became the assistant secretary two or three times after Phil Lee left. But Charlie really recognized the need to develop headquarters staff, their own budget shop, and so on, and get it back on the...
And on rebuilt the public health
service. Rebuilt the public health service so he could fight off the department.
Mm-hmm. Well, yeah. And he called you to Washington at that time to what, head up the end of HISMHA? My memory fails.
Yeah, when Nixon was reelected, he asked for the pro forma resignations of all of the agency heads in government. And my boss, who was the agency head, put his in, like everybody else, and much to his surprise, it was accepted. And
that was Vern Wilson.
Yeah.
Vern Wilson.
And so they asked me if I'd come to Washington and run HISMHA on an acting basis, knowing that if I would not accept the job, if it were offered to me, and so I was a safe person to sit there and run it while they found somebody foolish enough to run it or try to. And I went up on a Friday, the 14th of December was, and on the 15th of December, Saturday, we had to hear what our budget was next year, and that was the early Nixon rescission budget, which did away with all of our programs in the public health service. Did away with regional medical programs, it did away with smoking and health, it did away with health services, R&D, just all of the programs of HISMA. And I was faced with having to close the public health service hospitals. This was 72. And I was suddenly faced with having memos leaked to the press that I had signed saying that we were going to have to run a reduction in force of 7,000 people. And
there was a sizable cut in CDC's budget at that time, too.
Yeah.
And you want to talk about that?
Well,
prefer not to, I suppose.
Well, you know, you never like to talk about the bad things in life, but we had just taken on the smoking program then? We were just taking on the smoking program,
right.
And its budget was wiped out.
That's right. Exactly.
One fell swoop, it was gone. And we got some big cuts in CDC, and this is when we began closing field stations and running some more reductions in force and really tightening up and looking at really setting priorities of what was essential to be doing. And we closed Kansas City, Alaska, Alaska had been earlier when you
they
gave $1 million away.
They transferred.
You don't want to talk about that, huh?
We're into it.
they
transferred the Arctic Health Research Center into CDC and eliminated its budget,
yeah.
If I remember. That's what happened.
Yeah, and so they'd built it, much to everybody's disgust, in Fairbanks, where there are no people. But that's where the university was, so we kept trying to give it to the university. And the university...
The buildings.
And the university was very smart, and they say, well, the buildings are no good without any program or money to heat the building. So the end of the fiscal year, Bill Watson flew to Alaska and gave the university a check for $1 million. And we never know where that came from, Bill.
Well, the Alaskan congressional delegation maneuvered to get that money in as transition money,
yeah.
To close that center down. I mean, it really was a gift.
Talking about the congressional delegation, this was the era when several people in the Senate and the House really held sway over the health budgets. What was your relationship with was CDC's relationship with them?
This was in the process of really changing at that time. Fogarty had been running the appropriations situation in the House for years, and Lister Hill in the Senate, and both of them were very pro-health oriented, more to NIH than anything else, but they were good friends of public health in general. But by the time I was Well, actually, I only testified before Fogarty once, and then he died, and Dan Flood became the chairman, and then Lister Hill retired, and Kennedy picked up. Magnuson. And the in the House, the chairman of the overall Appropriations Committee, Mahan from Texas, had been so infuriated by Fogarty's being able to put everything in the health budget and then override the whole Appropriations Committee on the floor, he put in Dan Flood, who he considered to be a weak person that he could control. And was fairly weak in terms of his influence within the House. He had a great deal of influence over the government of the Canal Zone because he had sat on their Appropriation Committee, and every 2 years he'd take a cruise through the Canal Zone. But the congressional powers were shifting from the Appropriation Committees to the substantive committees, the authorization committees. That no longer was Fogarty important. It was Paul Rogers in the House who ran the authorization, who could tell you this is what you ought to do, but he didn't have any power over the money. And in the Senate, it was Ted Kennedy who was the authorization committee, and who would say you ought to be doing all these things, but he couldn't get the money in the budget either. So it was we became sort of a congressional stalemate, and the OMB became much more potent during those days.
Are there other personalities in this sphere that you'd like to talk about?
Surgeons Folk, general?
Surgeons general, or assistant secretaries for health, or secretaries?
The assistant secretaries were Phil Lee, and then Marty Duvall, and Roger Eggeberg. Never forget Roger Eggeberg coming to Geneva to Boston to address the opening session of the World Health Assembly when it was held there. And he hadn't really been confirmed yet, but they were having trouble with Johnny Knowles, and they were trying to get John Knowles appointed, and the AMA was so up in arms over this liberal that Bob Finch was going to appoint that they had to withdraw him, and Roger was substituted at the last minute. He arrived in Boston with a speech he'd never seen before to the World Health Assembly, and I forget him standing there reading it. Look, he couldn't believe the things that he was reading. Actually, the assistant secretaries over the years until Charlie Edwards really were not very potent individuals, and Charlie tried he was an old Booz Allen Hamilton consultant type. He tried to put some management into the office of the assistant secretary, and I think really strengthened it so that it now is a very, I gather, a very good buffer between the secretary's political motives and the real health needs. And Ted Cooper was in between, and Ted was served as a buffer. He didn't have he didn't have the managerial.
He succeeded Edwards.
Edwards, yeah. He had been Charlie's deputy, and then he became Charlie's successor. Ted didn't have the managerial feeling for that kind of a job. He was a lone worker and would go off on his own. He and I went off on our own together.
There's one interesting and rather short-lived piece of CDC's programmatic history that I think we ought to get on the record, and that is our involvement in the space effort.
Well, this was one of Dr. Goddard's, there were two involvements. One was from a microbiological standpoint. The NASA was looking for people to do low-level microbiology of contamination of surfaces, and Dr. Simmons, who was head of the old technology branch and an entrepreneur out of this world, could smell money anywhere, and he smelled some money there, and he got some for the Phoenix Lab to do that. But then Jim Goddard, he didn't have enough to do while he was here, and so he decided the space agency ought to have a committee of advisors to protect the Earth from contamination by the moon.
Back contamination.
And Jim had it all set up so he'd be chairman of the committee. And by the time the committee met for the first time, he'd been transferred to the Food and Drug Administration. I ended up as the chairman of a committee that dealt with such things as germ-free pine trees and shrimp from, they were oysters from the southern hemisphere and Japanese quail and a variety of things that we were using to make sure that the earth did not get contaminated by the moon. We sort of went at it as with a little bit of humor at first, but then Lassa fever came along just at the same time, and Marburg virus was found, and you say, there are things that we don't know, so we did begin to look at it more seriously, and this was there were humorous moments in it, as well as getting the astronauts back and out of quarantine.
This is a good place to stop. When we come back, we'll talk about some of the memorable people and some of the newsworthy things that happened during the 60s and 70s.